Welcome to Hope Church KC Online. We are Jason and Betsy Davis, and we are so glad that you joined us today.
We are. And today we just want to encourage you to engage in the service from your living room or from your home, wherever you are, just like you would if you were in the church building. We want to invite you to just tune out all distractions, really engage in worship today, and feel free to take notes. We would also love to see your church at home set up. So we'd love it if you took a picture today, tagged us in it. It's a great way for us to come together in community when we can't be together. We can meet together online. Right. Use the hashtag HopeKCFam so that we can find your photo. We're so excited to see how you're worshiping.
We pray that the service that we're about to enjoy together would inspire you and help you. And so sit back and enjoy the service.
Good morning, Hope Church. So glad you are here to join me in worship this morning. Let's worship the Lord for what he's done in our lives and for how faithful he is. And we're going to choose to praise him this morning. So sing with me, "Yes, I Will."
I count on one thing, the same God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will.
Be doing one more song, and I just kind of want to read this. It's Ephesians 2:10, this verse. It says, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." The next song that we're getting ready to sing is "Who You Say I Am," and in this song it talks about how God calls us chosen. He calls us his children, and he calls us his own, and that we are who he says we are. So as we sing this song, I challenge you to view the way that God looks at you rather than the way that your job defines you, or your wife or your husband or your best friends, because we want to operate from God's goodness and his kindness and the way that he looks at us. So let's declare that truth as we sing this song together.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me into his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. Grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Through the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Jesus, we worship you. Thank you for this time where we get to declare the truth that we are your children, that you call us your own. Thank you for that, God. You give us a purpose and a plan for our life. So help us to live out that plan. Help us to get closer to you in our lives, and help us to show that love to others. And God, I just pray for this new series that we're going to get ready to go through. I just pray that you would use this series to strengthen our hearts towards you and strengthen our hearts towards others. So we love you so much, Jesus. Thank you for the time that we get to worship you. And we pray this in your name.
Thanks for worshiping with us this morning. You know, those songs are incredible reminders that we are not what we feel. We are not what we've done. We are who God says we are, and we are his children. And the promises that he's made to us are truly, truly life-giving and incredible. And so thanks for joining us today. Thanks for being a part of our service. Before we move forward and get into the message, I'd like to just give you an opportunity to be generous if you're prepared to do that. You can go online on our website at hopechurchkc.com/give, and you can give online there, or you can text any dollar amount to the number that's on the screen. And if you've never done this before, then it'll give you a prompt and you'll be able to to follow that and set up an account. And it's the simplest and easiest way to give. And we are just so excited that you're with us. And if you're watching for the very first time and this is your first time checking us out, don't feel any pressure to give. We just want you to sit back and enjoy. Everything that we're doing this morning is designed to help you and to encourage you. And so I encourage you to get a cup of coffee and have a seat and let the message that we are going to share together right now just speak to you and encourage your life. Enjoy. Elie Wiesel was born in the town of Sighet, Transylvania. He was a teenager when he and his family were taken from their home in 1944 to the Auschwitz concentration camp. And his book, titled Night, is the terrifying record of his memories of the death of his family, the death of his own innocence, and his own personal despair at mankind's worst evil. As many of you know, Adolf Hitler and his Nazi war machine were fixated on the extermination of an entire race of people, the Jewish people. And during the years of World War II, they were responsible for the deaths of over 6 million Jews. Millions of lives lost, millions of families ripped apart. And Elie Wiesel was among those who survived and whose memories would continue to torment him for years after. And in his own words, he writes about the very first night that he was in camp when the German SS murdered his father along with the rest of his entire family. He said, "I remember that night, the most horrendous of my life, after his father had been beaten and he would lie dying on the floor." He records the words his father said to him, and as he was hiding in fear, "Eleazar, my son, come here. Come, don't leave me alone." I heard his voice, grasped the meaning of his words and the tragic dimension of the moment, yet I did not move. It had been his last wish to have me next to him in agony at the moment when his soul was tearing itself from his lacerated body, yet I didn't let him have his wish. I was afraid of the blows. That was why I remained deaf to his cries. Instead of sacrificing my miserable life and rushing to his side, taking his hand, reassuring him, showing him that he was not abandoned, that I was near him, that I felt his sorrow, instead of all of that, He says, I remained flat on my back, asking God to make my father stop calling my name, to make him stop crying, Eleazar, Eleazar, come, don't leave me alone. He says, his voice reached me, but I had not moved, and I shall never forgive myself. We will never fully understand what goes on inside of the mind of a boy as he watches his own father beaten and murdered, or as his eyes watch rings of black smoke unfurl into the sky from the smoke that's emanating from the furnaces into which the Germans have thrown his little sister and his mother. But all of this led Elie Wiesel to write these words, "Never shall I forget that night, the first night in camp, that turned my life into one long night." The story of Elie Wiesel and others like him show us all that something that's true for you and it's true for me, that no matter who we are or what we believe about God, that there are times in all of our lives where life can be dark, where we don't know what to do or say or think, and where we just can't seem to see clearly anymore, and we wonder why what's happening in our life is happening at all. And for all of us, when we feel that way and we're there, life can leave us feeling stuck, like he said, in one long night. Nights come to our lives when sickness hits, when disease wreaks havoc in our physical bodies or in our mental energies or in our spiritual resolves. Nights can set in when we've been struggling financially for as long as we can remember, and then we lose our job, and then we're furloughed or our hours are cut back, and now we're wondering, what are we going to do? How are we going to provide for our families? And fear sets in, and anxiety can be crippling to us. Nights set in when those closest to us hurt us, betray us, mistreat us. It's in the nights where pain and anger and vengeance can be like a wildfire raging out of control inside of us. Nights set in when the car or the house needs repair again, but we've got to decide whether we pay the bill or we repair what's broken. Nights, they set in when we bury someone that we love. Maybe it's a parent or a child, and we don't know how to move beyond that kind of pain. We just get stuck there, and we're not able to move forward. Nights hit when our marriages struggle, and the flame of love that we had for our spouse flickers and it fades. Nights can come like a wild bull, leaving a path of unbroken dreams, broken homes, shattered hopes, and as a result, our constant companion is pain, bitterness, and hurt. Nights come when we have more questions than answers, when we have more disappointments than dreams, more hurts than hopes. We don't know what to believe anymore. Nights set in when life goes left, but we wanted it to go right. And it can leave us angry and confused, as if God doesn't care and God's disappointed us and God's not even there. It causes us to descend into a heavy fog of depression where we don't feel hope, where we feel like nothing will change, and God doesn't seem to care about us, and we're all alone. And maybe that's exactly how you feel right now. We all walk through times like this in our lives, times that's just best described as darkness and night. And when life is dark, we don't know what to say or do or believe. So why does God allow these times? What is God doing during these times, and where is God at in these times? These are all questions that we want to answer in this new series that we're starting today called Night. And over the next several weeks, we're going to share real stories of real people who walked through their own season and time of darkness and night. And as we walk through their experiences together, my prayer is that not only will you be able to relate to what they're going through, but you'll also be able to see clearer in your own life where God is and what God is up to and what's he doing through this time that's so hard to see. We're going to explore the depths of what God does when life is dark, because nights come to all of us. It doesn't matter who we are. And if you search the scriptures, then what you're going to find is that sometimes God does his best work in our lives when life is dark. And if you're watching today and right now in your own life, you feel all alone, then this message is for you, because there's a man who knows exactly how that feels. His name is David. And there was a season in his life where it got very dark, and where those who were closest to David betrayed him and abandoned him. His world was flipped upside down in a moment, and he felt all alone, and he was literally running for his life. And to understand David a little bit better, you have to understand, you know, where he started from as a boy. You have to go all the way back to his childhood, because when he was a boy, he was anointed to be Israel's next king. But there was just one problem with that. They already had a king, King Saul. And as David grew from a boy into a teenager, he began to do incredible things that showed everybody just how much God was with David. So you see, when the army of Israel was paralyzed by the enemy Philistines and their giant champion, Goliath, it was David who not only had the courage to stand toe-to-toe to Goliath, but it was David who had God's favor and God's skill to defeat the giant. And everybody in the nation of Israel heard of the greatness of David and how God was with him as he slayed the giant and defeated Israel's enemies. And they all knew that God had plans for him. And as David grew into a young man, he lived up to the reputation that was around about him. He not only did he become a great warrior, but he became an incredible general in Saul's army. He defeated enemy after enemy, time after time. And David was becoming legendary. And everybody could see that while Saul might be their king now, God's hand was clearly on David. They all knew that David was the future of Israel. And naturally, all of that made King Saul extremely insecure and extremely jealous. So much so that on two occasions, Saul picks up a spear and tries to kill David. And as a result of that, David enters a time in his life where it gets very dark, and where for years he's running for his life, and every day he's hiding. And every day Saul and his army are hunting him, and he's not safe anywhere, and he's not safe with anyone. It's a season of night in David's life that's not fair, and it isn't right, because David's done nothing to deserve this. He's done everything right. He's been faithful to God. He's been faithful to his king Saul. But nevertheless, here he was in this season of darkness and night, and he was asking, God, why is this happening? Where are you? It was a time where David had more questions than answers, more pain in his life than peace, and more hurts than hopes. And maybe that's exactly how you feel. Maybe you can relate. But to all of our benefit, during this time in his life, he recorded all his feelings. He wrote down all his thoughts and his experiences and even his prayers. And he wrote them down into poems and into songs that we know today as the Book of Psalms. And they're beautiful and they're poetic and they're personal and they're extremely powerful. And though others write some of the Psalms and they contribute some of the Psalms, most of the Book of Psalms was written and recorded by David in moments like this that were dark in the nighttime of his own life. And before I read to you one Psalm that's going to kind of guide us through this series, I want to kind of give you the end of the story for David, because eventually God comes through for him and King Saul dies and David's no longer an enemy of the state and the entire nation rallies around David and they make him their new king. Everything happens just as God promised that it would. In fact, David would become Israel's greatest king. So great, in fact, that when Jesus comes later in the New Testament, the people refer to him as the Messiah, the Son of God, but he's the son of David, the next King David over Israel. And in the end, God works it all out for David. And though David didn't like the time that he was in the night and in the darkness, there's no doubt that when it was all said and done, he liked what God did better. And years later, with that season of night in the rearview mirror, he recorded something that he learned about God that might help you. It's something that I think that just didn't help his own life, but it reaches through the ages to you and to me, and it will help you and me maybe when we're going through our own night. And if you, no matter if you're a church person or not, I think this will help you, because if you're in a season of darkness and night where you feel all alone, then this is what David learned about God. And it's coming from Psalm chapter 91. No matter how dark the night might be, this is what David says. He says, "Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High during the darkness will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty." And he says, "I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust." David says, "Here's what I found in my own times of night. With God as my help, with God as your help, surely
Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. And no matter how terrifying and scary it might be for you, you will not fear the terror of night, nor the pestilence that stalks us in the darkness. I mean, looking back in his own life, David could say, God really does his best work when life is dark. And to better understand that, let me take a few moments and kind of unpack that thought, how God really does his best work in the times of our life where it's dark, because David learned a few lessons. David learned that despite what we might be feeling or what he might be seeing, the truth is we're not alone in our nights. In our nights, God is walking with us. When we're walking through dark times in our lives, it can feel scary. It can feel like we're all alone and God has abandoned us and there's no one to turn to. But David says that's not the case, because when he walked through his own darkness, and when he was alone night after night on the run from King Saul, whether he was hiding in a cave or in a strange town, no matter what he felt, no matter what he saw, David knew that at each moment God was right next to him. God was walking with him. And that's what makes it what he says in Psalm 91 so much more powerful, because he says in the night, God was his dwelling place. God was his shelter, his home. And he found that he was able to rest in the shadow of God, because God was so close to him. God became his refuge, his fortress, his safe place where he would run to because he trusted him. And in verse 4, David even says, God was faithful. He was present with me in that time. He was my shield. He was my strength. How could David see and hold on to God through the darkness, through his own night, when it's so easy for us to miss where God is and not know what God is up to? How could David do that? And the answer might surprise you. It's because he knew that the night, it doesn't change who God is, and it doesn't change what God can do. David knew that God is still God during the night. And though the darkness might scare and terrify us, God is still sovereign and in control over it. And he has promised to walk with us and to work for us even when life gets dark. David knew something about God that you and I need to know. And it goes all the way back to the book of Genesis in verse 1, where it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was formless and void and was empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep. And in the darkness, the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. David knew that in the beginning, even though darkness was everywhere, and though it covered the entire surface of the world, God was still there, hovering over it, present in it. In the darkness, God never left, and he never lost control. And even though it was dark, David knew that God could work something beautiful out of the darkness, something perfect, something incredible. God created everything that we know of through that season of darkness. And so in his own life, David knew that when it was dark, he knew that God was still able to bring something good out of it. He could still create something beautiful out of it because God was still with him. God was still in control. Even if it was hard to see God or feel God, he knew God was still sovereign. And his presence was still present with him. And even though it was dark, God can work it all together for good. And so maybe for you right now in your life, life is dark and it's hard to see God or feel like God is with you at all. And maybe because what's happening in your life, maybe it's even made you angry at God, made you walk away from God or abandon faith in God. When life is dark, it's easy for us to feel like we're all alone and God's abandoned us. Who do we have to turn to? But David says, don't buy that temptation because you're not alone. No matter what you see, no matter what you feel, God is with you and he's walking by your side. It's what led David to say in another psalm that in the darkness of his own night, the Lord is my shepherd and I lack nothing. He actually helps me to lie down in green pastures, peaceful pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. David says he guides me along the right path for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil because God, you are with me. In our nights, God is with us too. And even if we can't see him or feel him, he's walking right beside us, because that's who he is, and he never changes. The darkness doesn't change who God is or what God does, because he's promised he'll never leave us and he'll never abandon us. God is walking with us. But David also learned something else. He learned that in the night, while we have questions and we don't have answers, and when we feel a spirit of heaviness and trouble, and we're so worried and we're so terrified, that we don't need to fear because God is guarding us. The darkness can make us feel so many things. It's interesting, even as adults, how we can still be scared of the dark. The darkness, it seems, it brings out our worst fears. And maybe as you walk through your own season of night, maybe you're terrified of what's going to happen next. Your mind races and moves to the worst case scenarios, to what's going to happen if those worst fears are realized. If you're not careful, you can get lost in the panic and in the worry and in the anxiety and in the fear. And you can get stuck there. I mean, I think terror is a perfect word to describe how the nights can make us feel. It can leave us terrified. It can feel terrible. What will happen next? If our worst fears are realized, it's a terrifying reality. And maybe that's how you feel right now. Maybe in your family, or maybe in your marriage, or maybe in your finances. Now that the coronavirus has affected so many people's jobs and careers, maybe it's your health, maybe it's your faith. Maybe that's how the future feels right now. It just feels terrifying. You don't know what's going to happen. That's how David said he felt as he walked through his own season of night. And I can only imagine how he must have felt day after day while he was running for his life, wondering what the next moment would bring. What would he be caught? Would he be killed? Would his family or those he cared about be killed? Would everything that he hoped for, everything that he wanted, everything that God promised, would it all come to an end? It had to be a terrifying reality. And maybe that's how you feel right now. But that's why I want us to listen in again to what David said he learned about God in this dark season of night in his own life. He said that he knew God was with him at every step, because with God as my shelter, with God as my refuge, with God as my fortress in the darkness, he says you and I don't have to fear the terror of night. And you and I don't have to fear the pestilence that stalks us in the darkness. He says this in verse 9, if you and I will say, the Lord is my refuge, and if you make the Most High God your dwelling place, your safe place, then I assure you, no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near you. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all of your ways. He's saying that when you know God is with you, and when you know God is guarding you, then there's nothing to fear. There's no need to be anxious. There's no need to worry. Now, don't get me wrong, because the nights are terrible and they can feel terrifying, but they're not greater than God. I mean, on our own, with our own wisdom and our own strength and our own power, then there's a lot to fear, because the nights are long and they're scary and they're terrifying and they're bigger than us. But if we're trusting in God, and if we know that he's with us, then no matter what we're walking through or how scary or terrifying it might feel, we can know that God will guard us and keep us safe, and that God has a plan to get us through this terrible thing. And if you're watching, and listen, if you're not a church person and you're not even certain what you believe about God, then let me ask you this. How do you handle the terror and the overwhelming fear that the night and the darkness of these times in our life? How do you wrestle with the overwhelming nature of something that's bigger than you and greater than you? Because as followers of Jesus, we know that though they're bigger than us, they're not bigger than God. And what David is saying here is that if we'll just trust in God, and if we'll just run to God and lean into God during the terrifying night, during the terrible darkness that you and I might feel and experience, God can become the source of our strength and the source of our peace and the source of our hope. And if he's our foundation, he'll defeat the terror that paralyzes us. And instead of terror and fear, he will give you supernatural rest and peace in Him. It's a peace that Scripture says passes all understanding. And it doesn't seem to make sense because the circumstances around us just are so terrifying. But we, because God is with us, we can have His peace and His rest. And it can be ours because we know God is guarding us. As the Scriptures declare that God is our refuge and our strength. He's an ever-present help in times of trouble. So therefore, we will not fear because we don't need to fear. Though the earth might give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the seas, we know that though the waters might roar and the foam might come and the mountains quake with all their surging, because the Lord is with us, the Lord Almighty is with us, we don't need to fear. Friends, when you know that God is guarding you, and when you know that God is walking with you, then you won't fear either. You will trust, as David did, that God will do some of the best work in you in the times when it is darkest. David learned another thing. David learned that in the night, we don't need to rush through it, because through it, God is growing us. David would have never become the man that he did. He would have never become the king and the leader that he did had it not been for that season of night where things got really dark in his life. I mean, David loved God before, but it was during this darkness, this time of leaning into God, where he learned how to trust and love God in a deeper way. He had no other choice than to go right through the darkness. And as he did, he grew, he matured, he became stronger with his faith, stronger in his maturity. The darkness drew him closer to God and it transformed him at the same time. And the same thing can happen in your life and in my life when we walk through the darkness that we go through. It's our pain and it's the problems that we go through that can work inside of us to produce change in us and help us grow to become the people that God wants us to become. There's a stronger version of you on the other side of what you're struggling with. And you can't become that person unless you just go through it with God's help, because without the struggle, you're not growing stronger. And so maybe this night that you're walking through right now, as you're watching this morning, maybe this night is actually what God is using to help you grow, to become the spouse that you want to become, or to become the parent that you want to become, or to have the kind of faith that you want to have. But none of us like it when life gets dark. None of us enjoy it when life is hard. We naturally wish the darkness away. We want to do our best just to get to the other side. We want to rush through it because we just want it to end. But if God has a purpose for even the darkness and the nights of our life, if He has a plan that He's working it all together for good, and that includes our personal growth, if we'll just give Him the opportunity, He can use this to produce something good in us. David said that if we will trust what we're going through to God, if we'll take refuge in Him, then not only will God guard us, but God will, as he says in verse 12, He'll send His angels and they will lift you up with their hands so you won't strike your foot against a stone. And as a result of God's strength and lifting in your life, you will tread over on top of the lion and on top of the cobra, and you will trample the things that are there to devour you. You, in other words, though you're going through something dark and scary, and though you want it to end as fast as possible, if you will let God, even in this terrifying thing, God will make it so that this thing that terrifies you is actually what He uses to transform you. God will cause it so that the very thing you think that will consume you will actually be what God uses to change you and to grow you. And like David, you're going to find that as you go through the darkness, God will lift you and you will rise above it. And not only will you grow stronger and more in love with God and more faithful and more trusting, but you will tread and trample on top of the things that are dark and want to destroy you. And David's advice to all of us as we walk through our own nights is don't rush through it. Let God use it to grow you, growing your faith, growing your trust, growing your patience, growing you into the person God and you have always wanted you to become. Because maybe this is exactly what God plans to use to help you become who you've always wanted to be. I mean, in my own experience, that's exactly been the case. I've learned God wastes nothing He uses everything, good and bad and even ugly, together for his good to grow me. I didn't want the nights to come in my life when they came. I didn't ask for the darkness. It was terrifying. But because I knew God was with me, and as I walked through it with his help, through the struggle, I got stronger. And my experience has been like David's, that God really does his best work when life is dark. And David learned something else before I close that we need to know. David learned that in the night, we shouldn't try to save ourselves because only God can deliver us. Every single one of us are tempted to rely on ourselves when we go through darkness and we go through hard times and struggling, terrifying times. When we go through the night, we can rely on our own wisdom, our own strength, our own intellect. But David says we would be making a very big mistake if that was our approach. Because as David discovered, only God has the power to deliver and to save us when life is dark. Listen to what he says again in verse 14. This is God speaking. God says, because you love me. This is David looking back and what God has said to him. Because you love me, I will rescue you. I will protect you, for you have acknowledged my name. You have called on me and I will answer you. I will be with you in trouble. I will deliver you and honor you. I will give you long life. I will satisfy you and show you my salvation. This is David writing it years after the fact. And so whatever causes the nights in our life, our greatest mistake would be to trust in ourselves and to think that we have what it takes to get us through this, to get us through the other side, where we want to be and who we want to be. But if we rely on God, David knew that if he would just hold on to hope and faith and cling to God and trust the outcomes to God, even though Saul had the army, even though Saul was the king, even though David had nothing and all he had was God, David knew he had everything that he needed because God is enough. And maybe what you're walking through, the night that you're walking through, has been brought on because of sickness or maybe a financial problem, or you've lost your job or your hours have been cut back, or maybe you have problems right now at home and your marriages. However big they might be, however scary they might be, listen, you may feel like you don't have what it takes. You may feel like it's bigger than you and it's terrifying and you feel overwhelmed. But if you have God, then you have everything that you need. You have enough because God is able to do what you and I cannot do. And God does his best work in us when we go through the darkest times in our life. This is David's experience. This has been my experience. And I want this to be your experience so that no matter what you're walking through, you can know that you're not alone, that God is with you. And even if you can't see it and you can't feel it, you don't need to be afraid because God will guard you and God through it will grow you. And in the end, God will save you and deliver you. The night won't last forever and it won't always feel like it feels like right now, but it's what we let God do through us in the night right now that determines what happens next in our life. And so though it's terrifying, and we can trust that God will use it to transform us. That was what David experienced. That's what I experienced. That's what Jesus' disciples experienced. There was a point where the disciples were in a boat together and Jesus had stayed behind on the shore. And the further they went across the Sea of Galilee, the worse the weather got. And John, who was there, he tells us in his gospel that the weather got so bad and it got so dark that they were certain the boat was going to sink. They were certain that they were going to drown. They were certain that this was the end. And they began to ask the same questions that you and I ask. Where is Jesus? Why would he allow this to happen? This can't be the end, can it? They were asking questions that maybe you who watch today, you're asking in your life. Through the darkness, though, John said the craziest thing happened. And beyond the winds and the waves and the craziness and the chaos of everything that was crashing all around them, they saw something. They saw someone. And he was walking out to them on the water. And in the darkness of that night, in the craziness of that chaos, when they called on Jesus, Jesus came to them. And he got in their boat and he calmed their storm. And where there was chaos and darkness and fear and anxiety, Now, because of Jesus, because they knew God was with them, there was peace and hope and life. Because my friends, like with these disciples and like with me in my life, with David as well, we can know that we are never alone. God is with us. And in your time of night, in my time of night, in the seasons of darkness, it's God that makes the difference. Because as David said in his own words, the weeping might last through the night. Because God is with us, joy comes in the morning. And it's my prayer today for you that whatever it is that you're walking through, that you and I will see for ourselves in this darkness and in this night, how we are not alone and God can do his best work in you when life gets dark. Let me pray for you this morning. You know, Lord, the darkness can terrify us. The nights come and so many things can hit us, and fears and emotions are real and they're terrifying, and they can even become bigger than our idea of you. And even if we're a church person, we can struggle. But I pray that this morning you would give us the wisdom to know what to do with what we've just heard, and give us the courage to do it, to trust you in this season of night, in this time where it's dark and we don't know what to say and we don't know what to do. Give us the ability to see you through it and to trust that your presence is with us right now. We are not alone. Help us to have faith, to hold on like David did, to know that you will walk with us through this. And in the end, you will deliver us too. It won't always feel like this, and it won't always be like this. But God, right now, we're walking through difficult, dark times. And those who are watching me this morning are walking through very real struggles. I pray, God, strengthen them this morning. Encourage them this morning. Help them to see you and to trust you and to believe in you, no matter how it might feel or what they might see around them. Let them believe and know you are there. I pray it in Jesus' name, amen. And thanks for joining us this morning. And I appreciate being part of part one of our new series, Night. Join us next Sunday for part two of Night.